will be possible explanation also. As I said, for your unit test, which is scheduled from Monday, the syllabus is of two units. First is introduction of research methodology and research process, or you can say design. What happened? The Moodle, on Moodle, right now also check. I have requested the support staff to create one course, as it was for data mining, but still it is not there. I've requested one more time. If course get created on Moodle, definitely it will be better up to the Monday. Else, I'm planning that the data mining course is accessible to you, right? DM, which they have finished in first sem. So in that, at end, I will create unit test for RM. If your course on the Moodle for this subject, research methodology and IPR, is not created. If it is not there, definitely we'll create the unit test on the data mining course under that. Okay. So if possible, we'll conduct the test on the same DM course. Let's check whether it is getting created. One more time, I have requested the support staff who is handling the Moodle to create one course under the ME MTech course RMITR for second sem. Let us see what happens. Right now, we'll go for some discussion of MCQs. So screen is already visible to you. So questions, as I said, I have collected these questions. Probably I'm looking forward as a university examination point of view. Some questions I have collected, I will discuss here. Probably such kind of questions will be there. So the first question will take. So who was the author of the book named Methods in Social Research? So we do have options A, B, C, D, four options. Kirlinger, Pierre Kothari, Good and Hat, or Good and Hat, we can say like that, and Wilkinson. So Wilkinson is the fourth option. So correct answer is Good and Halt, actually. This is the idea. So explanation is the book named Methods in Social Research. So this was authored by, again, let me check the spell, but I think it is Gooden and Halt, on December 1, 1952. And this was especially aimed to improve students' knowledge as well as response skills. So this was about the first question. We'll move on. We can have an interactive session here. You can also try to guess first question, as it was already visible. I will try to hide the answer. We'll discuss and we'll go forward. This is how I have planned. So next is, let me check somebody's trying to enter. Okay, let me still. So the next question is, what is the major attribute of correlation analysis? The options are A, B, C, D. A option is association among variables. B is difference among variables. C is regression among variables, and D is variations among variables. So you have to tell what is the major attribute of correlation analysis. Yes, anybody will try? Yes. Can you guess correct answer? What is the major attribute of correlational analysis? Options are association among variables, difference among variables, regression among variables, that's the C option, and option D is variations among variables. You can type in chat box also, no problem. Okay. So the answer is option A, association among variables. So it is a major attribute of correlational analysis. Option A is the correct one, association among variables. Correlational analysis mainly focuses on finding the association between one or more quantities or variables. Even we can say independent variable. So that's why we say that correlational analysis major attribute is finding an association between one or more quantitative independent variables or quantitative dependent variables, right? So that's the correct answer. Option A, association among variables is the major attribute of correlation analysis. We'll move on. We'll go to third question. So what is the name of conceptual framework in which the research is carried out? What is the name of the conceptual framework in the research carried out? Options are research hypothesis, synopsis of research, research paradigm, and research design. So what is the name of the conceptual framework in which the research is carried out? Is the name of the conceptual framework in which research is carried out? Research hypothesis, synopsis of research, research paradigm, and last option D is research design. So correct option is research design. So research design is used which required before the research, so that we can understand what is the conceptual framework for research. So a conceptual framework can be understood as a research design that you require before you start your research, or you do research, or you go for research study, or go for research plan. So research design is the correct option. Okay, next question. So what is the main role of research in education? what is the main role of research in education? Options are, option A is to upsurge one's social status. Option B is to increase one's job prospects. Option C is to augment one's personal growth. And option D is to help an applicant in becoming a renowned educationalist. So here, you have to tell what is the main role of research in education. What is the main role of research in education? To upsurge one's social status, to increase one's job prospects, to augment one's personal growth, and option B is to help an applicant in becoming a renowned educationist. Sometimes what happens, if you concentrate on the meanings of options, there are more chances that you can have an association between the answer and the question. You can get an idea what will be an answer of a particular question if you understand the meaning of the options given. Somehow that is a very good technique if you haven't studied well. If you have studied well, definitely still some questions are tricky. There also you can apply your mind and try to get the options meanings. Definitely the question answer you can rightly choose. So the question is, why is research is required in education? Whether it is to improve one particular social status, one particular job prospects, one particular personal growth. So these three options, if we discuss, these are personal. It means we can say only individual. So only single individual is concentrated in three answers. But sometimes research is not only for single person. It can applied to general. If somebody goes for research by taking the knowledge of research, he can become a good researcher, right? So it is not only for single person. And if we check the first three options are, these are only single individual targeting a single individual. So probably I can say that these three answers are wrong. And if I see fourth option, so whoever is an applicant, if he want to become a renowned educationalist, definitely research will play a vital role here. So option D is the correct answer. So main role of research in education is to help a particular applicant to become a renowned educationalist. One particular researcher who wish to go for taking higher studies, researchers, educations, knowledge, information, definitely research will be the particular thing you can do. So option D is the right one. So educational research can be defined as an assurance for reviewing and improving educational practices. And these educational practices will result in becoming a famous renowned educationalist. So option D is the correct one here. We'll go to next question. So which of the following features are considered as critical in qualitative research? I'll read out the question once again. So which of the following features are considered as critical in qualitative research? Option A is Okay, hope I'm audible. So which of the following features are considered as critical in qualitative research? First option is collecting data with the help of standardized research tools, which is considered as a critical qualitative research feature. Feature is collecting data with the help of standardized research tools available. Option B is design sampling with probability sample techniques. Option C is collecting data with bottom-up empirical evidences. And option D is gathering data with top-down schematic evidences. Yes. So we are discussing which of the following features are considered as critical in qualitative research. Collecting data with the help of standardized research tools. Okay, you can say this is also a good feature, but we want a critical. Design sampling with probability sample techniques. Okay, we want to, when we go for explanatory or experimental or exploratory research, what we do, we collect a group of particular variables, samples. And we do experimentation, and based on the observations and results, we conclude, right? So that is the probability sample technique, design sampling. Collecting data with bottom-up empirical evidences, okay? Bottom-up, the approach is bottom-up, empirical evidences, okay? And gathering data with top-down schematic. If we see, there are two things which are given, collecting data with bottom-up and top-down. It indicates that probably out of these two, the correct answer can be. Now, when we do a qualitative research, we have studied inductive research type, right? So, an inductive methodology which is implemented in qualitative research, it is very important. And inductive methodology, always, so there are two, inductive and deductive, which we have seen in lectures. So, in inductive and deductive, there is a difference. And in inductive, what we do, inductive methodology starts from a particular to general, right? In particular, from particular to general. And if we say that society is there, then from bottom, so we study society from the bottom, and then we move up to make the particular observation as a hypothesis or theory. So always we study bottom and go upward. Always go for inductive methodology, which starts with from particular to general. Bottom to up indicates that from particular we are moving to a general. So I feel the correct option is collecting data with bottom up empirical evidences. That is related to your inductive methodology. So yeah, correct answer is collecting data with bottom up empirical evidences. And as I said, in qualitative research, we use an inductive methodology. And inductive methodology starts from a particular to general. So we can say that when we study a society from the bottom, we move upward to make particular observations at theories. So bottom up is the correct answer, option C. Next question. Probably we are not going to cover everything in this single lecture. We'll try to go max, or I want to give you the taste of MCQ type of questions which can be asked on the RM and IPR. Looking as forward to the unit test one. Okay, so there will be 30 marks test one of RM IPR. I think the RM IPR is the first paper on Monday. So I just want to give you a taste of kind of MCQ questions will be there, right? So we are not going to cover all entire things. Probably what is related, we can see. We'll just discuss here more in 5 to 10 minutes more. So next question is, how is random sampling is helpful? So random sampling, what we do, you should know it. So in random sampling, out of, suppose the samples are available 100, we choose randomly, we make a group out of available samples randomly, selecting anyone, not as a sequentially or descending or ascending order. No such orders we follow here. We choose randomly, right? So how random sampling is helpful? That is what is the question. And options are, first option is reasonably accurate. Option B is an economical method of data collection. Option C is free from personal biases. And option D is all of the above. Sometimes what happens, when there are options and the last option, or maybe in between one option, is there none of the above or all of the above. These are supposed to be the tricky questions. Sometimes none of the above or all of the above is the correct answer. But to choose that answer, we should see other options. What are the other options? So that's why these are the tricky questions, tricky answers. And these require thorough knowledge. If you have a correct information, correct knowledge about the question or about the concept which is mentioned in the question, definitely the answer is very simple. So how random sampling is helpful? What is random sampling? We have just right now revised one more time. Why we should go for random sampling? Because if we go as per the sequence, and if sequence, whichever options or samples which we are choosing, if they are having low values or high value, definitely answer will be according to the low values or high values. And if we choose random will give you option. We are not only selecting higher values or lower values, probably chance will be mixed. We'll select some lower, low, some higher, some middle one, like this, and the answer will be generalized. So it will not be a particular, and that's why random sampling is helpful if we consider it is accurate. So it is reasonably accurate. So option A is the correct one. We'll see now option D. Option D says an economical method of data collection. When we collect data, we collect thorough data, not only top samples or lower samples or middle samples, right? But when we do have a choice, and if we select random, this is the economical method, because we are not only selecting from bottom up, or from top to bottom. We are selecting any, which gives an option that as per the requirement, we can choose samples and we get a good accurate result. That's why it is economic. Option D also, I feel that it is correct one. So in this case also, random sampling is helpful. Now we'll see option C, because option C will decide the fate of this answer. Free from personal biases. Personal biases? No. Suppose we have decided that we will give gifts to the particular student, and if you are the topper, definitely you will feel I do have a good marks, I should get it. And somebody is very clever but not on paper, not by marks, is lower man. He also feel, or he or she also feel that I should get the gift because I am talented. Yeah, I haven't got marks in the examinations, but I'm very clever. I'm knowledgeable. I'm brilliant student. I'm sincere student. So here, teacher always do not make the bias. There are some standards which are fixed, right? So same, random sampling will not bias. That it will not select only particular threshold value and related values. It means only top values or only low values. We are randomly choosing. Maybe we select a few lower values, some middle values, and some higher values, right? So such kind of biases are not there. So the random sampling is free from personal biases. Option P is also correct. So random sampling helps option A, reasonably accurate. Option B, it is economically method of data collection. And option C is free from personal biases. So correct answer is all of the above. Option D is the correct one. So all of the above. In random sampling, for each element of set, each element of the set, there exists a possibility to get selected. As we are choosing randomly, everybody's possibility of getting selection is 100% probability. Right? So when we give gifts to the particular student, we put a criteria. And the student who fills in all criteria, not only one, not only two, all criteria we give the gift or praise him, right? Him or her. So same way. So free from personal biases, economical method of data collection, and reasonably accurate. So random sampling helps in all these things. That's why all of the above answer is the correct one. That's why I said when there is a none of the above or all of the above question is there, type of option is available for a particular question. Definitely, these are the tricky questions, because all of the above indicate that all three options should be applicable. None of the above indicate that not a single option is applicable. If any single option is applicable, we can say rather than none of the above, that particular option is correct answer. That's why these are the tricky questions you should have here. You should have the correct concept information. You should have the knowledge about it. I think questions and answers we have discussed. Okay, let me revise one thing. Hope you have gone through your mail accounts. Hope you have checked your inbox. So I have sent to everyone, I think. I also Dhanashree was absent yesterday, but I think her mail ID also I have added. I have shared books, REM books, whatever I do have e-copies, right? So I have shared them, and also I have shared today the assignment questions, assignment number one and assignment number two. So I have mailed it because Moodle account is not working right now. Moodle account in the sense the course of REM and IPR is still not created. So I have mailed. You go to your inbox, you check your inbox, you can find assignment file, असाइनमेंट फाइल असाइनमेंट नंबर 1 एंड असाइनमेंट नंबर 2, तो बोथ क्वेश्चंस और बोथ असाइनमेंट्स आर इन सिंगल फाइल. सो यू यू कैन स्टार्ट राइटिंग असाइनमेंट्स एंड आफ्टर यू कंप्लीट यू कैन स्कैन एंड सेंड टू माय मेल आईडी, और इफ इन बिटवीन आई विल बी एबल टू एक्टिवेट द कोर्स, आई शुड बी एडिंग द कोर्स इन द मूडल अकाउंट, देन यू कैन अपलोड ऑन द मूडल इटसेल्फ. लेट सी हाउ द थिंग्स आर गोइंग ऑन. आई हैव रिक्वेस्टेड सपोर्ट स्टाफ टू हेल्प मी इन क्रिएट, बट आई थिंक पाटिल सर हैज लेफ्ट द इंस्टीट्यूट. आई डोंट नो हु इज लुकिंग फॉरवर्ड नाउ द मूडल अकाउंट. लेट सी, आई विल इन्फॉर्म यू, बट मीन वाइल यू कैन स्टार्ट प्रिपेरिंग अबाउट यूनिट टेस्ट 1 एंड स्टार्ट प्रिपरेशन ऑफ असाइनमेंट्स. And once you finish, you can scan it, and meanwhile I'll inform you what to do. Probably right now the answer is you can mail me, but if Moodle account is course is getting added on Moodle account, definitely you can upload on it Moodle. So honestly, you also check your inbox. I have mailed one book, rather than one research methodology books, two books are there. I have shared ebooks. And also I have shared the file of assignments.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So all of you start preparing and writing assignments. So that will be your submission. Regarding unit test 1, also I have given the test of questions. Probably this kind of questions will be there. 30 questions. And regarding now all, I think one is absent. So. We can inform Chaitrali. Let us see how we are conducting unit test. If I'm able and successful to add the course on the Moodle, Moodle itself will have your test. But if it is not able, we will use the old course DM page. So you can log into, you can access the DM course page, and in that at the bottom I will upload the RM IPR unit test 1. You can appear there on Moodle itself. Okay, so keep this in mind. Still on the Monday morning, I will inform about same. Right. Keep in mind right now that we can access the Moodle of DM. You check whether you can access the DM data mining page, and on that at last we can have the unit test 1 of RM and IPR. Okay. I think that's it from my side. We cannot go to all the question sets. What I'll do, even possible, I will share this file. But after your unit test or before unit test, you want collected probably 50 questions. I will share this file to you. Go to the I have mailed also this file which we have discussed. You can study, but this is for entire thing, not only chapter wise. So you can just take a test of this and you can prepare accordingly as per the syllabus. Okay. So that's it from my side. We'll stop here. If you have any doubts, you can ask me. If you have any doubt, you can ask me. Else, we'll end this meeting.